Then the 11 disciples went away into Galilee.
Al monte que Jesús les había señalado.
When they saw him, they worshipped him.
But some doubted.
And Jesus came and spoke to them, saying,
All authority has been given to me in heaven and on earth.
Ahayal, ningal purappattu poi, sahala jadigalaiyum seesharaki, bautizándolos en el nombre del Padre, y del Hijo, y del Espíritu Santo.
Teaching them to observe all things that I have commanded you.
And lo, I am with you always, even to the end of the age. Amen.
And now choir and orchestra, just outstanding. Thank you, Bob. And thank you, choir. Thank you, orchestra. Good morning. I bid you greetings, grace, and peace in the name of God, our Father, Christ, our Savior, and in the power and presence of the Holy Spirit, our Comforter, Counselor, and Guide. I'm so glad to see all of you here this Sunday morning, and we welcome all of you who are watching online this day. Over the last 4 weeks, Mark Sorensen and I have put the Great Commission under the microscope of biblical examination. And we have attempted to share with you the what, the why, the where, and the how of this timeless directive given by Jesus to his disciples. It was his last earthly encounter with them as recorded in the Gospel of Matthew, the 28th chapter. And Jesus simply began saying, Go, and make disciples of all nations. I can only pray that you have gotten as much out of this series as I have. And by your response, you remember the little slips that you filled out and we put on the wall? You see there that you have just filled our walls with responses, and we thank you for that because it lets us know that you've not only heard us, but you're really ready, set, ready to go to action. And so this is what this is about this morning. We've taken this phrase verse by verse, line by line, word by word. And I'll be honest with you, there are some details about this particular passage, the Great Commission, that I have overlooked in previous sermons. Let me just share with you some of those details. One thing I came to understand is that this scripture represents the only strategy that Jesus used to send his disciples out to turn the world upside down, or should I say right side up. It's just simple. It's just profound. Nothing could be more simple than go. But isn't that just like Jesus? Simple yet profound. Just think of it. 12 men sent out with one story to all parts of the known world. That's what I've discovered first about this series. The next thing I discovered made it clear to me. If the disciples had stayed in Galilee and had not gone out from that place, the movement of Jesus, the Jesus movement, would have died right there in that area. It would not have gone out beyond there. So that was, it was important, and I understood this. I also understood that this was the Great Commission, not the Great Command. He didn't command them to go. He commissioned them to go. And that's a lot of difference. I think that Jesus just had the confidence and the faith that they would heed his instructions and leave that place and go and tell the world. And then I rediscovered this. I rediscovered how God actually works in situations like this. God had to close this door of personal relationship with Jesus and his disciples in order to open other doors of possibility and promise. And that's exactly what happened. And as Reverend Sorensen pointed out last week, we, like those disciples, are simply being asked to go and share our stories, our encounters with this man named Jesus, to a world that desperately needs to hear this life-changing good news that Jesus saves. And so, where does it put us on this final installment of the Great Commission? Well, hopefully, what we've shared and what you've heard puts all of us in a place where we are more aware, where we are more conscious of our responsibilities as followers of Jesus, prepared to go out as those disciples did to change and transform not only this community, but the city, the state, the nation, and the world. And so that's what this is all about. And so somehow I see us this morning in the starting blocks. You can tell I've been watching the Olympics too much this week. I see us in the starting blocks, okay? Down in the blocks, and I can just see this guy with his hand raised in the air saying, ready, set, go. But not so fast, my good Christian friend, before you get accused of having a false start. I have a word, I promise that's the last Olympic illustration you would hear. I have a word for you today. And that word becomes for me the most important part of the Great Commission. A word that guarantees us, that assures us that we cannot fail as we go to make disciples of all nations. Let us pray. A charge to keep I have, a God to glorify, a never dying soul to save and fit it for the sky. To serve the present age, my calling to fulfill. Oh, may it all my powers engage to do my master's will. Arm me with jealous care as in thy sight to live, and oh, thy servant, Lord, prepare a strict account to give. Help me to watch and pray and on thyself rely, assured if I my trust betray, I shall forever die. It was the great Anglican scholar and preacher by the name of William Barclay. Many of you have seen that name before. Brilliant scholar of many works. He wrote these words in a book which he called A Spiritual Autobiography. This is what he wrote, and you'll see it on the screen. I have always felt that Jesus is to be regarded not as a person who did things 1900 years ago, but as a person who does things now. Who does things now. I really like that quote because it reminds me that if we are going to continue the work that began on that mountaintop near Galilee, somehow we've got to convince ourselves, we've got to convince the people around us through the living of our lives that the miracles, the life, the wonders of Jesus are just as real, just as relevant, just as important now as it was then. In other words, there is no way that Jesus is going to allow us to let him stay on that mountaintop and just watch him ascend without sending us out. And when we go out, we've got to regard him. We've got to speak in that first person, what he's done for me. We've got to regard him as someone who's doing something for you now. That's what's contained in the word go. In essence, it's saying, take me with you as you journey. Let me walk alongside with you as you travel. You see, this may surprise some of you, but there are some well-intentioned Christians who have confined, who have relegated Jesus to the pages of some red letter edition Bible. And they won't let him out of that. A 2,000-year-old cry. People need to know that Jesus is alive. He is just as active, just as involved in our lives today as he was 2,000 years ago. I can't begin to tell you how many people come up to me every week here at the church, online, call me on the telephone. Will you please pray for me? Pray for my family. Pray for this situation or that situation. You know, things like operations or surgeries, things like medical tests and all those kinds of things, illnesses. And I don't mind doing that at all. As a matter of fact, I welcome that because that's what I do. I pray for people. And so I do that gladly. But when people call me back and say, my prayers were answered, you don't know your prayers helped us with the outcome and all of that. You know, I want to be honest with you. I have this thing in my mind when somebody says to me, your prayers helped us. I want you to know that it's not Bob Hayes. It's nobody but Jesus. That's important to me to keep this thing in perspective because, you see, I'm under no illusion that my prayers, my connection with Jesus is any better than yours. When I get down on my knees and pray, Jesus is not saying, well, is this call coming from the bishop or is this call coming? Uh-uh. No. It's coming from someone who's in need. And so my connection, my prayer connection, which is no better. I'm under no illusion. It's not any better than yours. But I am under the conviction that when victory is snatched from the jaws of defeat, when peace is found in the midst of the storm, when light shines into what was ordinarily a dark place, and it and pardon my English here, it ain't nobody but Jesus. You don't know how my computer was just spitting that word back. You can't say ain't. And I kept pushing, ignore. No, you can't say ain't. No, I can say ain't. It ain't nobody but Jesus. You see, let me share this story with you. I'll tell you this true story. Near McAlester, Oklahoma, is a tiny town, a very small town called Atoka, Oklahoma. Atoka. There sits New Zion United Methodist Church. It's back up in the woods, far off the main beaten path. A very small wood-framed church that has been there for over 100 years. In 2007, that is, a candle was left burning accidentally following a Christmas Eve service. And on Christmas Day, the people of the New Zion Church awoke to the devastating news that most of their church had been engulfed with smoke and a small fire. It was devastating. And so they woke up to that news. They called me and asked me to come and meet with them. And 2 days later, I journeyed to Atoka, Oklahoma to meet with them. They're only about 25 or 30 members of this small church. And on my way to Atoka, I just said in my mind, I could see them giving me the keys to the church, saying, we're going to close down. We're going to abandon the building, and we just wanted you to know. So that's what I had in my mind when I went to meet with them. And so here we are meeting in the parsonage right next door to the church. We're right in the smell of the smoke and the ashes that just a few days earlier engulfed that building. And I was expecting them to inform me of the bad news. But what I found when I got there was a group of committed, dedicated Christians, not only determined to reopen their church, but get this, they extended an invitation for me to come and preach their Easter Sunday reopening service. I said, what? You want me to do what? Here we are right in the shadow of this building, and here they are extending an invitation for me to come and preach the opening Easter reopening service. And so we made an agreement. I told them if you were ready to reopen by Easter, I would come back and preach your Easter service. And we closed that meeting with a prayer. I don't think I even got back to the main highway before they started working on getting that church back together again. Carpenters, plumbers, electricians, people from all around Atoka and McAllister started refurbishing New Zion Church. A lumber company donated the wood to rebuild the altar and some pews that had been caught afire. A hardware and appliance store donated light fixtures. Fire and smoke restoration crews began their work of getting the smoke smell out of the building. And an electronics store outfitted the building, get this, with a new Bose sound system. Not just any sound system, a Bose sound system. Put speakers all through the... All of this was just donated labor and on a minimal cost of materials. And they worked and they worked. And just a few days before Easter, the last item on their list had to be achieved. How would they replace the old Hammond organ that had been in that building for so long? A Hammond organ. I didn't realize until after the mid-service that we've got a Hammond organ right over there. But they didn't have the organ. And so they prayed about it, and with time running out, I'll tell you how Jesus works. Somebody got online and saw a media post, social media post, of a Hammond organ for sale from Tampa, Florida, for $39. All they wanted was, if you come and buy it and pick it up and take it away, you can have it for $39. It was the exact organ that they had. So somebody went online and purchased the Hammond organ online. Now, the question is, how do you get a Hammond organ from Tampa, Florida to Atoka, Oklahoma in just a few days? Well, let me tell you. It turned out that a relative of one of the members who was coming to Atoka for the grand reopening happened to live, you got it, in Tampa, Florida. He lived in Tampa, Florida, and was on his way to Atoka the next day. He went and picked up the organ, put it on the back of his truck, and drove it straight through to Atoka. It got there on that Saturday afternoon. They plugged it in, and Sunday morning, the Hammond organ was in place. When I walked in that pulpit on that Sunday morning, that Easter Sunday morning, and looked out at those people, they were just beaming. Oh, they had accomplished something. And as I stood behind the new pulpit, watching, looking at the light fixtures and all of the altar rail, and hearing myself talk through the new Bose sound system, tears just started running down my face. And I was at a loss for words. Write that down. Bob Hayes was at a loss for words. Was at a loss for words. And I just opened my mouth, and the words that came out of my mouth were these: I serve a risen Savior who's in the world today, not yesterday. Who's in the world today, I know that he's living no matter what foes may say. I see his hand of mercy. I hear his voice of cheer, and just the time I need him, he's always near. He lives. He lives. Christ Jesus lives today. He walks with me and talks with me along life's narrow. He lives. He lives salvation to impart. You ask me how I know he lives. He lives within my heart. Those people at Atoka knew that. They knew. if I had to figure it all out again, Jesus beat me to them. He was already there. He assured them that it was going to be all right. And it was. Nobody but Jesus. Something tells me, I have a feeling, that a lot of you in this room and watching online today, you know exactly what I'm talking about. Because I see it. You see it all the time. And the reason why we see Jesus at work all the time is because our faith has led us to believe that Jesus is always continuously working, bringing out the good of every situation. And throughout my life, throughout my ministry, I have always understood Jesus to be a miracle worker, a way maker, a savior who opens doors, a problem solver, and a friend who makes things happen now. And the only way that I can describe it or explain it sometimes is just simply say, nobody but Jesus. I love the writings of William Quayle. William Quayle was a bishop in the Methodist Church who was elected in 1908. He served in the Great Plains area, even served in Oklahoma. His writings, his memoirs are legendary within the Council of Bishops. And William Quayle writes one night of how he was pacing his bedroom floor, trying to find the answer to a perplexing problem. And he paced back and forth, trying to discover what can I do, what can I do? And Quayle writes in his memoirs that it was at that moment that Jesus was there at the foot of his bed. He said, I saw him just as if I were looking in a mirror at myself. I could see him there. He sat on the edge of the bed and he asked me, Quayle, what's the problem? What's wrong? And Quayle said, Jesus, I can't figure it out. I have a problem that there's no answer to. And he writes, Jesus said, well, Quayle, since I've got to be up all night anyway, why don't you just go to bed? You go to bed, I'll be up. And Quayle said he went to bed. And the next morning that he woke up, the answer was there. Oh, my friends, we shouldn't be surprised at this. Because whether you know it or not, Jesus promised this. And that brings me to the word that I want to leave with you this morning. The word that boldly proclaims victory for us as we seek to change the world through our witness. And I want you to hear, because this is the word that just was spoken to me this week, and it's his parting words, his words of reassurance. It's the last words of the Great Commission. And this is what he said, and lo, I am with you always, even to the end of the world. And there's another translation that says, I am with you always, even to the close of the age. Any way you say it, and the reason I know this is because I was present in seminary class that particular day. We went over this scripture when it says, if you say the end of the world or the close of the age, it's all the same. All I know, it's a long, long time. And so, therein lies the key to what the Great Commission is all about. It is the promise, it is the assurance that when we are sent to go, we do not go all by ourselves. Jesus said, I will be with you. And I have discovered that that is so true. And one more truth is that not only is he with us, but Jesus so often goes before us to prepare the place for us. You ask these people who work in missions. Many of you in this room have been on mission trips. Some of you work in prison ministry. Some of you work with Emmaus. Some of you work with other organizations. There's no way in the world that you could do what you do without Jesus being with you, without Jesus going and preparing that setting for you so that when you walk in, they know that you are representative of Jesus. That's what those disciples discovered. And so in my mind, there's no other way to explain it, that Jesus is with us. You know I like the hymns. You've heard me pray my hymns. You've heard me say my songs. But the most fascinating part of the hymns are the stories that come out or stand behind the hymns. One hymn in particular is Fanny Crosby's Blessed Assurance. You know that song well. But let me tell you the backstory. Mrs. Crosby, Fanny Crosby, was invited to visit her friend Phoebe Knapp, K-N-A-P-P. She was a friend of hers, and the family was having a large pipe organ installed in the Knapp home. And they wanted Fanny Crosby to come and hear a new melody that Phoebe Knapp had written. And they wanted her to hear, be the first to hear it on the organ. But that was a problem. As it turned out, several components, several parts of the organ did not make it. And so it rendered the musical instrument useless and incomplete. Saddened but undaunted, Phoebe Knapp then got up and went over to the piano and played the melody that she had just composed. She played it for Fanny Crosby. And after playing it, she turned around and looked at Mrs. Crosby and said, What does this tune say to you? After thinking for a moment, Fanny Crosby said, that song says to me, blessed assurance, Jesus is mine. And right there on the spot, in the year 1873, in that living room of Phoebe Knapp's home, they wrote the words, she wrote the words to blessed assurance, Jesus is mine. And there's a lesson in this story that I want you to hear. The lesson is this: our witness would be rendered incomplete and totally useless, just like that organ, if Jesus was not with us in what we did. He is the missing piece. He's the other component. And there's no way that we could ever be successful in bringing people to Christ without his divine presence lingering and hovering over us. And because he is with us, we have the blessed assurance that we need. But let me tell you what I like about this passage. Lo, I am with you always. Because it reveals that Jesus is not going to ask us to do anything or go any place where he is not going to be present. It means that we can go in confidence, just like those disciples did. They went, and every one of them died a martyr's life, sacrificing themselves for the sake of the gospel, for the sake of the story of Jesus. And the only thing that makes sense to me, how could they do that? The only thing that makes sense to me is that Jesus was with them even in death. In this 10th chapter of the Gospel of Luke, there's this passage that you heard read that says Jesus appointed 72 others and sent them out two by two ahead of him in every town and place where he was about to go. I don't want you to miss that right there, because the significance of that line is that it says he was going to the place there himself. He gave them instructions to proclaim the kingdom of God is near. And he said to them, he who listens to you listens to me. He who rejects you rejects me. But he who rejects me rejects the one who sent me. And it ends by saying the 72 returned with joy and said, Lord, even the demons submit to your name. Did you notice that the real joy, the real source of delight and satisfaction of the ones who were sent was not the consciousness of having great powers or authority, but it was in the awareness that Jesus was with them. In other words, it was not what they possessed. It was the one who possessed them. And it will never, as long as you're witnessing, it is never going to be about us, but it's going to be about whose we are. Jesus reminds us that he will be with us to the end of the age, to the close. Jesus said, I'll be there with you. And so this is what it all means, and I'm finished. When the curtain falls on all human history, he will still be our Lord and our friend. No matter what happens in our universe or in the worlds beyond which we have no knowledge of, it will never usurp his power. When mystics tell us everything matters and nothing matters, it leads and ushers us into a noble truth that only Christ matters. And he will be with us always, for he is the present day, the up-to-date, the modern-day Savior, who is both contemporary and eternal. He is Jesus, our Redeemer, our friend and sovereign Lord. And so let me just leave you by asking you this question. Have you ever weathered the storms of adversity and hardship and pain, and you knew from the beginning within yourself that you did not have the strength to overcome them, but you overcame all those things anyway? Have you ever wondered how you did that? Nobody but Jesus. Have you ever had your back up against the wall of fear, uncertainty, and doubt? We've all been there, and there was no window or no door in which to escape, but somehow, some way, you got out of there. Nobody but Jesus. And lastly, have you ever lost someone that you love so much? We've all been there. Have you ever lost someone that you love so much and your heart ached so badly, so much that you thought you were going to die yourself? That's how pain wraps you up. But somehow in time and in healing, you've come to understand the beauty and the power of the resurrection. Nobody, nobody but Jesus. And so when he says, lo, I am with you always, even to the end of the world, even to the close of the age, take him at his word. Know that he will fulfill his promise. How do I know? This is my story. This is my song, praising my Savior all the day long. In the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit.